Going to start your lecture series on bio instrumentation. Okay, so bio instrumentation it is very important subject, and maybe in your entrance examinations 15 to 20% of the question comes from this one, and it's an applied biology, means you will have the job prospectus more in bioinstrumentation. In future, if you people want to study bioinstrumentation, you can go for M.Tech and so, and you will get a good job over there. You can see the screen, and what do you understand by this? You can just say. We're going to see what is force is equal to gravity constant mass of one object into mass of second object by the distance r. Okay, so generally what is force? Force is nothing but it's a power to do anything. Yes, and mass into acceleration is force. We are going to discuss this in detail, okay, because at the end of this particular lecture you should, all of you should be get aware with the term called force, centripetal force, centrifugal force, frictional force, and the other formulas and equation. This centripetal is a Greek word which actually means center seeking. Center seeking or towards the center. You can see my the force which is act towards the center, it is going towards the center. So this force is called centripetal force. Okay, when an object is moving in a circular path around a fixed center, there is a force created which is called centripetal force, which push the object outside. See the direction of this particular object. How many of you have the experience in what you called merry-go-round? Hello, understand this with an example. Suppose we have a tennis ball. Okay, this girl is having the tennis ball with a string, and this girl is rotating this particular tennis ball. We are going one by one. So see, because things will go get more complex later on. So from here, you just try to understand what I am saying. If you have doubt, you can ask me. Okay. So there is a fixed center, and this girl is rotating this particular ball, for example, okay, which creates a force which is mass into acceleration. Obviously this ball generally have a mass, and while it is moving it creates an acceleration. So now tell me, it is a linear velocity movement or a circular velocity movement, the example which you had seen right now?
Circular.
Yes, yes. Circular. Circular. Okay. So it is not a linear one. Instead, it is a circular one. Okay. So we are going to understand this particular phenomena only. When an object moves in a circular path, what happens? Okay. It have many velocities, means here the velocity is different, and maybe in this point the velocity is different, means the speed is same but the direction of this particular ball is changed. Are you getting what I'm saying? See the change in the direction. Are you people getting what I'm saying? Change means the velocity direction change in different times. Okay. So when this occurs, so this is your mass and this is your acceleration. Okay. And meanwhile, when it moves in this particular direction, it creates a net force towards the center. That force is called force. Good. Okay. So this particular string means there is a force inward towards the center. That's called centripetal force. Okay. And centripetal, as I already told, this is center seeking force. Okay. So the force which act inward direction. Okay. This is the force which is acting inward direction. And tangential velocity means each time there is a change in the direction. If I cut this string, what will happen? The ball will go to this particular direction in which it is being cut. So, tangential velocity, the change in the velocity of a particular object. Okay, and we have a force which is acting towards the center. It's called centripetal force. Okay, similar thing you will most probably experience when you in the roller coaster round. This particular roller coaster doesn't get fall down because of this particular centripetal force. Okay, so we have, when an object moves in a circular path, there is a force which acts towards the center and its velocity continuously changed. Okay, so in this particular case, as I told you, force equal to mass into acceleration. Here the acceleration is further segregated into velocity square divided by r. Okay, r is the radius and v is the velocity, because this v and r is creating the acceleration. So this v square by r is here a. Are you getting? Earlier I told you, force is equal to mass into acceleration. So acceleration I had segregated into v square divided by r. Are we clear? And see some more examples, and we see some of the other forces. Okay, so again the same example, we have a string. Now this time it is actually connected to a drum. Okay, so the rate of change in the velocity each time, okay, because in this particular time, if I cut this particular string, it will move to this particular velocity direction. Okay, in case of an object moving in a circular path, the net force is called centripetal force, which acts towards the center, which pulls the object towards the center. The centripetal force is the tension on this particular rope. All of you know is representing velocity, green is representing acceleration, and this red one is accelerating centripetal force. Okay, so what happens when an object moves in a circular path? Okay, so if we change the radius, what is going to happen? What is going to happen if I change the radius of this particular string? Does it affect the whole path as well as the force? Parameters, if we change one, these two others is also changing. Okay, so here force is equal to m v square by r. Okay, so when we cut it, it may move in this direction, which we see in the case of example with the ball also. Okay, so now take the example of our earth and moon. Okay, same example. Now you come to my previous slide, that mass of one object and mass of another object means these two objects attract each other. Law of gravity. Okay, with the some distance. This distance is called r. Okay, so we'll come back to what. Okay, it's again showing. So okay, what's here? What we learn is objects attract each other with certain with the distance r. These two objects attract each other, and this velocity, acceleration, and centripetal force having the relationship. If we change one, the two other will also change. Okay, so Newton's third law of motion that every action has equal and opposite reaction. So there is a force which is acting towards the center. That means there will also be a force which act outside the center. Are you getting what I am saying?
Yes, sir.
That force is called centrifugal force. Okay. Don't worry about these equations. We will drag out this equation. We'll first you understand the concept, then we will go with the equations. Okay. So whatever we change, we have the change in the rotations. Okay. So now, what is the basic principle of centrifugation? Centrifuge is a machine, is a device to separate particles from a solution according to their size, shape, density, viscosity of the medium, and the rotor speed. In a solution, just take a live example. Take a glass of water and try to add some of the particles. Those particles who have the higher density will sink first, yes or no? And the lighter particle, then the solvent float. Like for example, if you take petrol and add to the water, what will happen? What will happen? Density of petrol is lesser than water. Okay, so what we learn, greater the difference in the density, faster they move. Means obviously if you have a heavier particle, it will go down. If there is no difference in the density, the particles stay steady. Are you getting what I'm saying? Take some example of oil and try to mix equivalent oil. For example, if you take two different oil having same density, they will suspend but they will don't mix up. That is called isopropyl conditions. These particles remain steady. To take the advantage of even tiny difference in density, what can be done? I mean, for example, if I give you a handful of sand and I tell you to separate the particles in the sand, what you are going to do? Anyone? I'll give you a glass of water and give you soil which contain many particles of different size. How you can able to separate it? You just put the soil in the water and slowly what will happen, the dense particle will settle first.
Yes, sir.
Then the lighter one, then the lighter one. Okay. To take the advantage, means if I want this process to be much faster, what I will do? I'll spin that particular glass of water. If I spin it, what will happen? That process of sedimentation become faster. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so here what we are saying, to take advantage of even tiny difference in the density to separate various particle in solution, gravity can be replaced by much powerful force called centrifugal force. Gravity is a weak force. Okay, so here we are going to use much powerful force called centrifugal force. okay, which is provided by the centrifuge. Are we clear? Can we go to next slide? Biological centrifugation. You see, whenever, suppose this is a cell, and here I have written something, for example, 6% of the cell contain Golgi complex. Golgi complex means if you take this cell and if you fragment it, 6% is your Golgi complex. Nucleus is generally, we have only one nucleus in one cell, and that the proportion of it is, 6%. Rough endoplasmic reticulum. You know what is rough endoplasmic reticulum? You might have studied in cell biology, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So rough endoplasmic reticulums, 9%. Mitochondria, powerhouse of the cell, 22% proportion, and generally in number, 2000 numbers per cell. Okay, peroxisome, 400, 1%. So similarly, lysosome, endosome, pre-ribosomes, cytoplasm, because we have only one cytoplasm, this particular liquid in the cell, and it is generally 54%. Okay, and just typically the size of a cell is 10 to 30 micrometer. Are you getting what I'm saying? Micrometers. Biological centrifugation is the process that uses centrifugal force to separate and purify the mixture. Means if I want mitochondria separately, rough endoplasmic reticulum separately, nucleus separately. So like the example of my soil in the water, organelles of a cell, we need to do centrifugation. Okay, so the much denser will sediment first. Okay. It is a key technique to isolate and analyze the cell. Okay, if you want to study mitochondria for your research work, for example, you need to separate the mitochondria from the cell. Okay, so for that particular process, we are going to use centrifugation. Okay, subcellular fractions, supramolecular complex, protein complex, okay, carbohydrates, proteins, nucleic acid can be separated. Okay, in this slide, you can see some of the vials. These are called centrifuge tubes. This one is called microcentrifuge tubes. Okay, and these are all centrifuge tubes in which we are going to separate. For example, if you want to isolate DNA, RNA or protein, you have to use this. Okay. Are we clear with this particular slide? The basic principle of sedimentation, like I told you, the effect of sedimentation due to influence of Earth gravitational field. For example, you all know that G is equal to 981 centimeter per second square, versus the increased rate of sedimentation, which is much, much more than your gravitation. That is what means if this task of sedimentation takes one day, we can do it in fraction of second using centrifugation force. Okay. So in this, when designing a centrifugation protocol, for example, if you want to isolate mitochondria, okay, so the density of the cell organelles is this 1.1 to 1.6 gram per centimeter cube. Okay. And the more dense the biological structure, faster it will sediment. Okay. For example, all of you know what is rotation per minute. For example, if I want to isolate DNA, okay, rotation per minute will be more or less as compared to organelles.
Yes, sir.
Okay, just understand my question, what I'm saying. I have the centrifuge which actually work on 2000 RPM, 4000 RPM and 6000 RPM. Okay, rotation per minute. And I want to isolate organelle first. It would require 6000 RPM or 2000 RPM? A basic question. I am not going into the much part of calculation.
Organelle, it's so denser, so it requires a less RPM, sir. So
2000. Yes. This is what you have to understand. Means, see, which is more dense, okay, we require to have less RPM. Okay, so a more massive a biological particle is, the faster it moves. Okay, so here is a question for you. Which of the molecule will sediment first during centrifugation of a cell? Which will first sediment? This is the question. Protein is much denser, so it will sediment first. Are we getting?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now let us understand it in more detail. The denser the biological buffer system is, the slower the particle move in a centrifugal field. What does this mean? In case, just go to our previous example. In case of water, I had given you a glass of water and handful of soil. In case of water, if I had given you some oil, what will happen? Sedimentation will fast or slow. Similarly, the denser the biological buffer system in which, for example, if I actually told you to isolate the DNA, what you are going to do, you are going to take the cell and you are going to crush it. Yes or no? With the help of some enzyme. And what will happen? The cell membrane bursts. And when the cell membrane bursts up, the cytoplasm come into the environment. Okay? Suppose I have, take an example. For example, I had given you some leaf and I told you to isolate the DNA. What you are going to do first, you have to crush the leaves, isn't it? So that the cell membrane,
yes, sir,
bursts up and all the subcellular content will come up in the environment. So that makes a biological buffer system in which you are going to do the centrifugation. Okay, so the denser the biological buffer system is, the slower the particle will move in the centrifugal force. Are you getting what? The greater the frictional coefficient, the slower the particle move. Okay, frictional actually by the Newton third law, we generally know that for every motion or for every force, there is an equal and opposite force. So if this particle is sedimenting downwards, there is a force which will act upward. Are you getting what I'm saying? Suppose this motion is downward. If this particular particle is moving down, there is an equal and opposite force upward. Okay, and when we have that particular force is called frictional coefficient here, because by this we are going to derive an equation. That's why I am explaining certain factors. Okay, so you have to recall all these factors when we are going to derive those equations. Okay, greater the centrifugal force, faster the particle sediment. Okay, the sediment rate of a given particle will be zero. This one is very crucial. Understand, we can say that the sediment rate of a given particle will be zero when the density of the particle and the surrounding medium are equal, because at that time it is not going to sediment down. Getting? So we can move to next. Biological particles move through a viscous medium, experience a frictional drag. What do you mean by frictional drag? In our previous example, like I told, if this particular object is moving downwards, there is an upward force acting on it always. Okay, so the biological particle which is moving downwards, sedimentation, okay, there is an opposite force. Okay, so that is where frictional drag, and this force acts in opposite direction to the sedimentation and equal to velocity of the particle multiplied by frictional coefficient. See, this particular particle is going down, that means it has a velocity. Yes or no? This again, this particular object is, for example, moving, and it is going in this direction. In this particular case, this is our microcentrifuge tube, this one. Okay, take this as an example. This is our microcentrifuge tube, and in which you have cells, for example, and allow it to centrifuge, means to move in circular motion. What will happen? Your protein or subcellular content is going down, so that is going to sediment, and at the same time there is a force acting upward. That particular force is equal to the velocity of the particle going down into the frictional coefficient. Means the obviously when there is an hindrance, okay, that friction is your frictional coefficient. I'll give an example of friction, and when the force is exceeded, how the particle sediment. Okay, so I'll just try to move up, but just give me a minute. See, there is one example. This is a simple motor pump. This particular action pulls up the water from the ground. Okay, this is called centrifugal pump. Okay, and this centrifugal action, you will get the water outside. Okay. And see, and now take an example of a wheel. Suppose you are driving a car in a muddy road. What will happen? When the acceleration is less, you can see the mud along the tire. Yes, and when the acceleration is more, what will happen? Due to this particular friction of the road and the interaction of the wheel with the road, all the muds will swipe off when the friction is more. But there is a force, which is, this particular example shows that there is a friction force always. If I come to our particular example, in this particular case, when you add a biological buffer system, you understand what is buffer system? That buffer system create a friction which doesn't allow our particle to go down so easily. So when we increase the speed of our rotor, what will happen? Similar examples, what that particular friction force, okay, we exceed that particular friction force and particle sediments. So there is an always, there is an opposite force to the sedimentation force. That force friction is equal to your velocity of the particle multiplied by the frictional coefficient. So angular velocity, what is linear velocity? What is linear velocity? When a particle moves in a
straight line.
Yeah, a linear direction, that is linear velocity. Now angular velocity, if a particle moves in a circular path, okay, the rate of change of angular velocity of a rotating body. Okay, so in this introduction class, for this introduction class, we are going to understand this particular centripetal force and centrifugal force. Okay, so deriving the equations may be the later part.